tonight on KPBS Evening Edition. A violent arrest involving San Diego police.
Because no child should have to go through this and deal with the police in such a manner.
Video shows the arrest on ground and in the air, but different stories are emerging from police and the man's family. And the federal case against the accused synagogue shooter, how prosecutors will pursue hate crime charges.
So we wanted to get input from other youth like us and get them to tell us how they feel City Heights can be improved or how it is now.
Understanding City Heights from its youth, the takeaways from a two-year survey of young people about their community.
So we made it and designed it to be mobile, that anybody could read the play, look at the projections, and act it out. And it would be equally as effective from a school of performing arts or to the local library doing it.
And using the arts to protect kids from human trafficking. KPBS Evening Edition starts right now. Good evening. It's Thursday, May 9th. Thanks for joining us. I'm Ebony Monet. A violent arrest caught on camera has San Diego's police chief defending his officers. The man's family says it's a case of police brutality. And KPBS editor Tom Fudge shows us the video. And a warning, some viewers may find it disturbing.
Bystander video of what appears to be the violent arrest of Trinell Cannon first appeared on Wednesday. Officers can be seen punching Cannon as he lay on the ground. Later in the day, his family and friends accused police of brutality.
Because no child should have to go through this and deal with the police in such a manner.
Cable, they're fighting with him on the ground. Multiple units 97 for cover. They yanked your S1 out, and they're fighting with them, the rest of them at gunpoint.
Police Chief David Nislight said at a Wednesday news conference his officers only used the force necessary to arrest Cannon.
Believing Cannon possibly had another weapon, responding officers used a combination of physical force and distraction strikes to take him into custody while continuously giving him orders to surrender.
San Diego police released helicopter and body cam footage also on Wednesday. They were arresting Cannon on an outstanding warrant on robbery and felony weapons charges. Chief Nislight said he resisted arrest, and the two previous times Cannon encountered police, he was armed. Police say they recovered this gun during their pursuit of Cannon that they believed to be his. San Diego City Councilwoman Monica Montgomery, who represents Southeast San Diego, said in a statement, "The eyewitness video depicting police officers exerting use of force is deeply troubling. As I clearly stated in my Public Safety and Livable Communities Committee work plan, police accountability and transparency are my top priorities." Tom Fudge, KPBS News.
Chief Nislight says the department will review the officer's conduct. Some members of the community are demanding an independent investigation. The man accused of carrying out a deadly shooting at a synagogue in Poway faces more than 100 new charges. KPBS reporter Andrew Bowen explains. Federal prosecutors say it was a hate crime.
The shooting at the Chabad of Poway Synagogue on April 27th terrorized the congregation on the final day of Passover. It's that terror that's the basis for the federal charges announced today. The federal complaint has a total of 109 hate crimes and civil rights violations. That's two for each of the 54 people in the synagogue during the shooting, plus one for the attempted arson attack on an Escondido mosque in March. Robert Brewer, U.S. Attorney for the Southern District of California, says the suspect sought to obstruct people's constitutional right to practice their religion.
The defendant violently targeted members of the synagogue and the mosque for no other reason than his hatred of the Jewish people and those of the Muslim faith.
There were a few details of the shooting that came to light. The weapon used was this model of semi-automatic rifle manufactured by Smith & Wesson. Prosecutors say the suspect picked it up at a licensed gun dealer in San Diego one day before the shooting, apparently breaking no laws. The suspect already faces state charges, to which he pled not guilty. Assistant U.S. Attorney Shane Harrigan says he'll be arraigned in federal court next week.
Ultimately, the decision on what case is tried first or how this is handled will be a joint decision. And understand, though, that any decision that is made will be in the best interest of the case and of ensuring that this defendant can be punished to the full extent of the law.
Prosecutors say they'll determine whether to seek the death penalty after consulting with the survivors and the entire Chabad of Poway congregation. Andrew Bowen, KPBS News.
Prosecutors say the accused Poway shooter shared his ideas on fringe websites. But extremism is also an issue on mainstream sites. AP reporter Krista Fourier shows us how it's being spread on Facebook.
Set to upbeat music, a photo celebrates two men with black jihadi flags burning an American flag. But this video wasn't created by the Islamic State or other militant groups.
You can see balloons covering up all kinds of horrible images of terrorists on the ground doing horrible things. And that's not created by the people expressing affiliation with terrorism. It's created by Facebook itself.
These auto-generated celebration videos and business pages, including this one of an al-Qaeda group that features the bombing of the USS Cole, are part of a complaint filed with the Securities and Exchange Commission against Facebook. In documents obtained by the Associated Press, an anonymous whistleblower alleges the social networking giant has been misleading shareholders by exaggerating its success in removing content that glorifies extremist groups. In the face of criticism, CEO Mark Zuckerberg has repeatedly highlighted the company's ability to weed out the content using artificial intelligence.
We now have AI systems that can identify and take down 99% of the Al-Qaeda and ISIS-related content in our system before someone, a human, even flags it to us.
That's just stretching the imagination to beyond incredulity.
Amr Al-Assam is a professor of history and anthropology at Shawnee State University in Ohio. His research was cited in the SEC complaint against Facebook. He and other Syrians have been tracking the looting and smuggling of antiquities. He says the activity on Facebook is helping fund the Islamic State and other groups.
It's a very convenient space that these people can interact, that they can message to each other, that they can recruit from.
Other research in the SEC complaint shows that during a five-month period last year, about 38% of the violent posts were removed. But much of the extremist content, including an execution video, remained easy to find. The complaint also identified over 30 auto-generated pages for white supremacist groups. The attorney for the whistleblower hopes sanctions will force the company to boost its efforts.
To think that actually is a tool that organizations are using to recruit people suggests that this is the worst kind of crime that's happening on Facebook. And we feel like we have a responsibility to put an end to that.
In a statement to the AP, Facebook said, quote, "We are detecting and removing terrorism content at a far higher success rate than even 2 years ago. We don't claim to find everything, and we remain vigilant in our efforts against terrorist groups around the world." Social media companies have broad protection in U.S. law from liability stemming from the content that users post on their sites. The question raised in the complaint is what happens when Facebook itself generates the content. Krista Fourier, Associated Press.
Governor Gavin Newsom is adding $4 billion to his budget plan. The revised budget is $213 billion, a $4 billion increase from the January budget proposal. The extra money includes an additional $150 million for local governments to deal with homelessness. Lawmakers must pass a new budget by June 15th. San Diego County is also planning its next budget. KPBS health reporter Susan Murphy looks at how money might be spent on mental health.
Nearly 165,000 people experienced a serious mental illness in San Diego County last year, according to the California Healthcare Foundation. Many showed up to a hospital emergency room, leading to a continuous backlog of available beds for other patients.
We are feeling increased pressure recently to provide acute inpatient psychiatric care.
Dr. Luke Bergman is director of the county's behavioral health services. He says part of that pressure stems from the recent closure of Tri-City Medical Center's mental health units in the North County. Under the proposed budget, spending on behavioral health services would increase nearly $50 million over last year. It would pay for 177 additional mental health beds, including at the county psychiatric hospital.
And so one of the things we're doing is increasing staff at the county psychiatric hospital so that we can help alleviate some of that pressure across the county.
Bergman says long-term care facilities are another priority. Currently, an estimated 50 people each day are on a waiting list for a long-term bed placement.
We know that one of the problems that we hear very often about from our hospital partners, but also from community members, is that there aren't enough places for people with really serious mental illness to go, for example, after hospitalization.
The budget also pours money into mental health outpatient care and walk-in services. County supervisors are scheduled to hold public budget hearings beginning June 10th. Susan Murphy, KPBS News.
Young people in City Heights have come together to survey other youth in their community. As KPBS reporter Priya Streeter tells us, it's an effort to dispel stereotypes about the neighborhood.
Halima Musa and her cousins moved to City Heights from Kenya as young kids. Now the young women are in college and have made it their mission to be ambassadors of City Heights to the rest of San Diego.
Most of the time when the media comes into City Heights, it's only to report on stuff that's bad, but when youth are being involved in like political action or being involved in their school, nobody's really there to like showcase it and to let people know that youth in City Heights are actually invested in their community.
The group is called City Heights Youth for Change, and it's made up mostly of first-generation African refugee students. In the past few years, the group has worked to get halal foods in schools and also worked to increase voter registration numbers in this neighborhood. The latest project the group tackled, a survey of 300 City Heights young people to document how they view their community. Musa says they wanted to control the dialogue about where they grew up and let local leaders know what the next generation thinks they need to focus on.
We felt that as City Heights youth, we're never really the forefront of telling what City Heights is like, so we wanted to get input from other youth like us and get them to tell us how they feel City Heights can be improved or how it is now.
The survey took almost 2 years to complete. The group looked at young people's feelings towards law enforcement and educators and safety in their community. They found that as City Heights youth got older, they said their relationships with law enforcement got more negative. They also found that young men were more likely to have a negative relationship with police than young women. Sara Makoma, Musa's cousin, says some of the findings surprised her.
Most of the younger kids that are the same age as me, they don't really trust the police either because of the conflicts that happen between the youth and the police officers.
But not everything from their results was negative. Musa says she was surprised by some of the positive perceptions young people had of City Heights, like the way they saw their teachers.
We found that most students feel like their teachers are really engaged in what they're learning and they're really helping them throughout the process of like becoming better students or better people, and they're invested, but they just don't have like the resources to make sure that their students are actually successful.
The other big takeaway the young women hope gets the attention of City Heights leaders is the youth's perception of safety in their community. They found that as young people got older, they tended to feel less safe. They also found that young people felt the least safe in parks around schools in City Heights.
People feel like schools, specifically parks surrounded by schools, are like the most unsafe parts of the community, which I feel like should change because that's where kids usually spend their time.
Isha Makoma, Musa's other cousin, says even though City Heights needs some improvements, she wants the rest of San Diego to know how great her neighborhood is.
It's a great community to live in. The people are very, very friendly. It's very diverse. And everybody, like, once you tell them, like, to come to a place, they will all, like, be helpful. They're very helpful around here.
And they're hoping that helping spirit can be harnessed to drive change in City Heights. Priya Sridhar, KPBS News.
The FBI ranks San Diego among one of the most dangerous places for human and sex trafficking. To help protect kids, the district attorney's office is teaming up with San Diego Public Schools. And here to talk more about it is San Diego School Board President Dr. Sharon Whitehurst Payne and Roxanne Carrasco, an instructor at the San Diego School of Creative and Performing Arts.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, Dr. Whitehurst Payne, can you tell me how are San Diego Public Schools just taking on this issue?
Well, we're doing several things.
And the primary thing that we're doing is trying to educate everyone. So we have our counselors informed and the teachers who are working with our children day to day. We're teaching them signs and ways that they can observe what's going on, because often it happens that it's right next door to you and you're not aware of it. So we're doing workshops for teachers. We're also just checking in with our counselors to be sure they've done it. Throughout the system, we're doing trainings so that folks are aware of what's happening with human trafficking.
And Ms. Carrasco, you're an instructor at SCPA, and can you tell me about the play Trapped, which tackles the issue of human trafficking, how it all came about?
Yeah, it was really interesting. The Department of Justice, alongside the San Diego Human Trafficking Task Force, which is a group of people at the state, local, and federal level that team together to basically catch people in human trafficking, came to us with an idea of, could we produce a play written by students for students to create awareness on the stages that happen in human trafficking? As an instructor of theater, I thought, yeah, I have students that can write this if I team with the right English teacher, and I have students that can act this. So the principal and I decided that it was going to be the wise choice for us to take on this project. So we spent all of fall into early spring developing it with an advanced English class and a professional playwright. We used the 8 stages that the task force presented to us of how a victim is pulled into the trafficking ring. It was upsetting to read. The 8 stages are so minor that you don't even realize that your own child could be falling victim to those. So I asked for more support, and the task force came back and did seminars and workshops with our teachers and our students to help them understand the gravity and how deep this goes, and how to identify in case you're being lured in, but also how to identify if your friend or classmate, is falling victim to it.
And how does the content from Trapped compared to what the students typically perform? I would imagine this is a very serious, timely, heavy issue.
So normally, the students that were involved with this perform musical theater, sometimes deep, sometimes light material. The students at first were a little reticent because they weren't getting to sing and dance. But the techniques that we use in musical theater are a little more on the forefront, a little more indicative, not as naturalistic necessarily as straight theater. So to switch into a more informative youth theater presentation was very easy for them. And so therefore, it became an incredible project that they're super proud of, because upon reflection, I asked them, what'd you take out of this project? They said, just that we saved one life. I know we saved a life today. And for me, that was win-win, and for the district as well. We could see that there was an impact immediately after the performance went on.
Even during the performance, I was there during the premiere event, we could hear the students in the audience. They were engaged. They were going, oh! They identified with it. It was so real for them. I've never seen it like that. I mean, they were just totally engaged.
And you say you were in the audience as well, and you talked about the impact to the students. But what was your reaction?
I felt like weeping because you see the impact of what's happening to children, happening across society, and to know that San Diego is one of the critical places where people come in.
With such a positive, powerful reaction from, you know, the students and faculty, what's next for the play?
What's next is exciting. We're going to take it on the road.
We're going to spend a portion of the summer packaging this play with the Department of Justice and the task force so that we could actually give the packet, the projections, the set, the script, the costumes and the props to any school that wants it to be able to put it on. We can send it to a community center. We can send it wherever. So we made it and designed it to be mobile, that anybody could read the play, look at the projections, and act it out. And it would be equally as effective from a school of performing arts or to the local library doing it. So we look forward to getting it district-wide soon, and then eventually nationwide. It's possible.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're still going to be calling for wet conditions across Southern California in the last 6 hours on your radar and satellite, showing moisture not only for Southern California, but back in towards Nevada portions of Arizona. We have two features here, a low out towards Nevada that continues to push its way a bit further to the west, but also an upper level low that will be coming out of the Pacific. Between those two features, some cooler air for tonight, tomorrow, and even into Saturday, as well as a chance for wet weather. So some showers into San Diego, especially as we head into the late night with a low of 60. We'll also be seeing those late night showers for Oceanside with a low of 55. Inland areas, not talking about too much in the way of wet weather for tonight, but notice the clouds really picking up for Mount Laguna with a low 43 and cooling down to 62 in Borrego Springs. Showing the future cast here starting off at 8 p.m. tonight. Lots of clouds. And then as we really continue into the overnight hours, that's where we start to notice some showers bubbling up for the coast, but also in inland areas. And that's going to be the trend into your Friday afternoon and evening. By Friday, 8 p.m., moisture on the faint side and clouds really dominating. But we'll continue to see a resurgence of that into Saturday and even in towards Sunday, especially in the higher ground. So here's our low pressure system, our upper level low, going to be taking its time moving inland, bringing some cooler air, not only for Southern California, but back in towards Arizona. And that wet weather going to be extensive here in terms of not just seeing showers at the coast, but even into San Diego. We're looking at a high of 68 with showers and the chance for thunderstorms as that upper level energy continues to swing its way inland. Also looking at thunderstorm and shower activity for Mount Laguna for tomorrow with a high of 50. Borrego Springs, a high of 81 with showers and thunderstorms likely. Saturday comes along. We're still in this wet zone, very warm out towards the northwest. Our temperatures here at home going to be in the lower 70s at the coast. Saturday, passing shower. Sunday still won't rule out some shower potential. And then Monday and Tuesday, we're looking at a drier forecast and warming trend here. Inland areas, you'll get out of the cool zone by Monday and Tuesday in the mid to upper 70s. Wet conditions also likely in the deserts. Thunderstorms for tomorrow. Saturday still could see some wet weather on Sunday with a high of 84. And also going to be keeping our eye out for stormy conditions in the mountains where we have the best chance for some heavier downpours and the potential for some localized flooding. We'll be drying out for Sunday and continuing into your Monday. Reporting for KPBS News, I'm your AccuWeather meteorologist, Daji Swad. Back to you.
California is among 33 states urging the federal government to open up the banking system to cannabis businesses. Banks can be held criminally liable for doing business with cannabis companies because marijuana is still illegal at the federal level. 33 attorneys general have signed on to a letter urging the passage of a bill that would end the restrictions. They say the bill would make it easier to track financial crimes and collect taxes from the industry. Some of the events for Mother's Day weekend include comedy, music, and dance. KPBS arts editor Nina Guerin tells us what's happening around San Diego.
Did you know May 10 is Mexican Mother's Day? And a perfect way to celebrate is with a concert by Mexican-American musician Lila Downs. La barca en que me iré. Downs is often compared to a musical version of Frida Kahlo because her work is so passionate and always infused with Mexican influences. Whether it's a mariachi song or lyrics about her home state of Oaxaca, she embodies a love for Mexico throughout her work. But at the same time, Downs blends her songs with musical influences from the United States, where she also grew up. So her unique sounds also have hints of jazz, blues, and soul. Maybe Mother's Day is more about family jokes and observations. Luckily, one of the all-time great comedians is in town, Jerry Seinfeld.
The donut hole. The donut hole. Let's stop right there. What a horrible little snack. If you want a donut, have a donut. Why are you eating the hole?
In his early years, Seinfeld's TV show was basically about four friends getting in awkward situations. But these days, his stand-up focuses on things like family and aging. Of course, Seinfeld still makes his jokes about the mundane, whether it's observations on parking spots or raisins. These are the jokes that have kept him so popular for more than 30 years. Finally, for those mothers who love to dance, or just new experiences, consider a modern take on tap dancing with Dorrance Dance. Michelle Dorrance, a 2015 MacArthur Fellow, founded a tap dance company that's unlike any other. You won't find Broadway moves at this show. Instead, an electronic soundtrack guides movements that are more about rhythm and musicality. Dorrance Dance turns the entire stage into an instrument, and the show features 8 dancers and 6 musicians all working together to create one of the most original shows you'll see. For KPBS Arts, I'm Nina Guerin.
You can find tonight's stories on our website, kpbs.org/evening edition. Thanks for joining us. Have a great night.